Panthers hockey is on the air. The final week of the regular season is upon us, and it's the final meeting between the Panthers and Canadiens. Three of the first four have gone to overtime, and today Dan Ellis gets the call in the cage for the Cats against the Canadiens. Welcome, everybody. I'm Steve Goldstein here on Fox Sports Florida. Hey, welcome back, Denny, after the one-game absence. Glad you're feeling better, buddy.
Well, maybe 80%, you know, but we old hockey players, we play at 80% sometimes.
Heck, you used to play at 50%. Who are you kidding? The Panthers have been at a great percentage this year, Denny. Despite the disappointment of not making the playoffs, they are the most improved team in the league.
The plus 21 is explainable. The Florida Panthers last year had 29 victories, 36 this year. And another very telltale of why it's a plus 21, they have been in double the amount of games, meaning in OT or shootouts. So they've gained extra points along the way. The Florida Panthers, it's not just a team effort. It was built on the back of a lot of young players having outstanding seasons.
All right, let's get into some of those young players led by the team's leading scorer in points, Jonathan Huberdeau.
Well, you know, we start with Huberdeau because he has had maybe the biggest increase of any player from last season's point total. There you see him scoring that zip-around goal. He is a plus 23 in points over last year. Barkov, same thing. He is a majorly improved offensive player from last season. Again, rounding out their talent, and this time, Brendan Perry. You all seen what he's done the last couple of weeks. And again, those three young players, a big part of why the improvement has been drastic, and we expect that it's going to continue.
And you know, you talk about first-year head coach Gerard Gallant, Danny. He's really handled this team well. What have you liked about him?
You know what I've liked about him is that he hasn't imposed his will on them. He has learned about his young hockey players just like they've learned about him. And I like the way that he lets them play. You sometimes see a guy make a mistake on the ice, whether a veteran or a young player. Gerard Gallant sits him for a moment, gets him right back out on the ice. That's how you improve the confidence of young players and even at times older guys.
And with these young players, Gerard Gallant sees this Panther team going into next year improving even more.
I just see more growth from our young players. You know, we got a good solid core of veteran young players, but I think we made big steps this year, and I think we're just going to make that many bigger steps next year. We got a good core of players that are probably going to come up and make our team next year, but our young players are really good young players.
In goal today, the likely Vezina Trophy winner for Montreal. It's Carey Price against the Panthers, and Aaron Ekblad in the running for the Calder Trophy. Billy and Drew discuss it next. Panthers Hockey on Fox Sports Florida is brought to you by your South Florida Lexus dealers. Proud sponsor of the Lexus Rink at the BB&T Center. By ADT, the most trusted name in security. Call 1-800-510-9067 for your free ADT quote. And by Subway. Visit Subway.com. Subway. Skate hard, eat fresh. A picture-perfect Easter Sunday in South Florida. We get set for the Cats and the Canadiens. Here's Drew Goldfarb and Bill Lindsay. Fellas.
Goldie, thank you very much. A great matchup here between Montreal and Florida in this late afternoon contest here in for our Cleveland Clinic of Florida Players to Watch. We want to take a closer look at a couple guys who could be bringing home some hardware in a couple months, including one of the, I guess you could say, one of the best goaltenders easily in the NHL.
Carey Price for the Montreal Canadiens. Incredible season. Montreal is 22nd in goals per game, so Carey Price has to been able to shut the door. He's done that for Montreal. They're at the top of the Atlantic Division, tied with Tampa Bay. Carey Price has done everything in net for Montreal. He leads all goaltenders in every single major category. For the Panthers, Aaron Ekblad, consistency is the word. He's been good offensively, really strong defensively, both ends of the rink. He's got it done. He's played in every single game but one for the Florida Panthers. He's led the charge from the blue line. We take a look at our NHL award candidates. Montreal, Carey Price, he will be a finalist for the Vezina and the Hart Trophy. Devin Dubnyk, what a pickup in Minnesota. Pekka, outstanding numbers in Nashville. For the Calder, Aaron Ekblad, that plus 11 rating leads the Florida Panthers. Philip Forsberg struggled a little bit in the second half. Johnny Gaudreau has not. He has had an exceptional second half in Calgary. I think Gaudreau and Ekblad will be the two favorites down the stretch for the Calder.
And Goldie, for today's game against Montreal, there is a lot of talent on display.
Thanks, Drew. Jaromir Jagr is tied for fourth on the NHL's all-time scoring list. He's been super since becoming a Panther. Max Pacioretty having a huge season himself. The Panthers and Canadiens bear down next. both national anthems of the great countries of Canada and the United States of America have been sung, and here we go, ready for hockey, the fifth meeting this season, and BB&T takes us inside the nets. Denny?
Well, Carey Price, the odds-on favorite to win the Vezina and the Hart. His first time in South Florida. Both the games he's faced against the Florida Panthers have been in Montreal. And the Panthers now welcome him into their barn. So why not try and crack his shell? Dan Ellis has played against the Montreal Canadiens. Has had a good run of it. Lost by one goal. Sounds like a familiar scenario for the Florida Panthers. His numbers are excellent in the games that he has played. A .922 save percentage.
And when Luongo was hurt, he kept the Panthers alive there for a while and only allowed 14 goals in those seven games. And here's Gudbranson quickly moving in and throwing one wide. Barkov, Huberdeau, Jágr on the ice. Canadiens trying to get their game back in the final week. Mitchell with a good hit on Pacioretty because Montreal has lost three in a row and five out of six, and now in a tie for first place with the Lightning in the division. This is Pacioretty. What a season he's having again. Centering feet, has a man, the shot, Dan Ellis. A big glove save on Markov to start us off.
What happened to covering the front of the net? Oh, my. Dan Ellis has a glove like a third baseman. It's soft, and it attracts pucks, and he needs it. Take a look at the top of your screen. In comes Markov sliding in. Look at the amount of open ice there is in that area. This is a dangerous piece of ice to leave open. Markov steps into it. Great save.
Petrie throws one right in front. Carries all the way through. Steven Kampfer in the lineup today, but he's playing forward with Boland and Jokinen. Little lineup changes. A couple of subtle ones for Gerard Gallant's team against the very speedy Montreal team. Every game has been a low-scoring battle. Petrovic hammers one towards the net. It's blocked by Gallagher. Here comes Montreal. Galchenyuk up on the wing. Gallagher. Shot deflected in behind Dan Ellis's net. Panthers play everybody in their division four times, but two teams they meet five times. And this year that was Buffalo and Montreal. Plakanitz played it off the outside of the Panther net. Here's Kampfer. Able to clear it all the way down. The Panthers will get a line change. Two more after this one for Florida. Thursday night, Boston. That will likely just be a huge game for the Bruins. And then the Devils on Saturday night. It's fan appreciation night. Come on out to the BB&T Center on Saturday against the Devils. There'll be tons of giveaways, autographed merchandise, Fitbit bands, concert tickets, and a whole lot more. Trocheck, Hayes, Peary on for Florida. Sent in front, Trocheck. Played it to the point for Campbell, but he had trouble with it, and it comes out of the zone.
Little miscommunication out there for the Panthers. Not yet in sync, but you know, Montreal Canadiens having lost three in a row. You can always tell a coach is not happy, obviously, and he has juggled all his lines. Michel Therrien.
Carey Price has given up eight goals in his last two games. A tough stretch for the goaltender that's likely to win the Vezina Trophy.
And that's monumental for him.
That's just like, does not happen very often.
No, 8-2. Normally that's about 13 games worth for Price this year.
You know, Tampa Bay's put a little pressure on him to finish first in the division, so there's a reason there for them to start playing better hockey.
Do you think it matters a lot with the break they'll have after Saturday's and Sunday's finales? Does it matter that much how much you're playing going into the playoffs?
It's a home ice advantage, and it doesn't matter in the first couple of games. But once you get a couple of injuries, you get a couple of guys not feeling well, you're much better being home to treat those injuries than on the road.
So you think it matters more for literally having the home ice advantage, not so much for momentum of playing well going into the playoffs?
Right, that's exactly right, and I feel that way because it also matters more in the early rounds.
I think you can flip the switch.
Yeah. Well, you have a few days off, and I guess there's been teams, you know, charging down the stretch, and you win 8 out of 9 to make a playoff run, and then you lose game one, and I guess all that just goes away, and it works the other way, too. Steal here in front, Jágr is robbed, and then Huberdeau with a chance. Oh, Barkov set up Jágr right in front, and Price made the save. Huberdeau takes the hit, because if he touched the puck first, it would have been a hand pass. Smart play by Huberdeau. Jágr battling Yemelin. Huberdeau's got it from the sharp angle. Fan on the shot, though. Jágr working. And the Canadians forced to ice it against that top line for the Panthers.
You know, again, this line just continues to have fun, and that's a key word right now. You're not going to be in the playoffs, but you want to have fun. It's a game you chose to play and sacrifice for your whole life. Here's the time to have fun. And this may just be resembling of what the Florida Panthers season is like. They've had goaltenders make great saves. They've been very close in many instances, but just not close enough.
I love that Barkov just kept his feet moving on that forecheck. Never stopped. Lifted the stick of Petrie, sent it right out in front for Jágr for the chance. But that line works so hard.
They have been fun to watch. How about Jágr wearing the A on his sweater here in this game against Montreal for the first time as a Panther? He and Boland with the A's.
Whoops. Whoops. My father used to say, hoopalai.
Now Campbell all the way back in his own zone. And Galchenyuk takes away. Tom Gilbert up at the point. Now Galchenyuk takes a shot, knocked down in front. Cleared up the boards, but not out. Campbell tries the other side, held in again at the point by Beaulieu. Gallagher for Gilbert, and the wrister. Oh, and Plakanitz had a collision there with Dan Ellis. We'll get a whistle and a stoppage. Lexus has our keys to this game.
Well, I tell you what, the keys for the game, let's start planning for next year. How about scoring first? That would be a key, something the Panthers have not done very well throughout the course of the season. And then again, let's get out of those 3-2 losses. Have the Florida Panthers start thinking 3 goals minimum per game.
Before last night's shutout loss to Tampa, they were averaging 3 a game since Jágr's arrival. Ellis with another stop there, that on Subban. Dan Ellis coming right in and sharp early on. Canadians with another chance here, and Ellis makes the save. Wow, Dan Ellis with some big stops here in the opening 5 minutes. Price had one on Jágr as well. And Price will grab this and hold it. Baptist Health has our scratches. And, of course, Nick Bjugstad out for the year. Tough loss for the Panthers with that. You see Gerard Gallant giving Aaron Ekblad some instruction. Al Montoya still out for the Panthers. And Upshaw and Boys are the healthy scratches.
You know, there's a play there that sort of defines a really good hockey team like Montreal. Campbell tried to make a pass to Ekblad. Ekblad started moving before the puck got to him. And it was really sort of an innocent, you know, misread. But by the time the puck got back in the Florida Panthers zone, the remainder of that shift and well into the second shift after that, Montreal never let the Florida Panthers get out of their zone. Little mistakes. Okay, a team like Montreal that's fighting for the divisional lead, they can make you pay.
Important game for Dan Ellis, too.
Oh, there's no question.
And playing for a job.
Yeah.
I mean, he's fighting for his life to stay in this league, whether it's the AHL, NHL, but this is an important stretch for him, and he started strong.
Well, I don't think there's any question that he gets at least a two-way contract somewhere, I would think.
Penalty coming up.
Yeah, an interference call here on the Panthers. So the Canadians will get a power play. But I think Ellis, you know, get a two-way contract at minimum. He'd like a one-way deal. And still down and behind the play is Pacioretty.
Yeah.
Went down hard there, and boy, ooh, he's looks a little wobbly.
Florida penalty, number 7, 2 minutes interference.
That is one thing Montreal fans do not want to see.
No, they can't afford that. You're 100% right. I think he just fell more than anything else.
Watch the head hit the boards.
Ooh.
That's what happened. I think the injury, to me, I don't want to speculate, but his head hit the boards pretty hard at the end of that.
Well, you know, there's been some upper body head issues, unfortunately, for the great goal scorer, Max Pacioretty. What a player in his career, and you hope he's okay as he heads off the ice.
All of Montreal right now is holding their breath. Max Pacioretty, fourth in the NHL in goals, had an outstanding season. They need him for the playoffs.
Yeah, and he's been going pretty good, too. You talk about playing well going into the playoffs. He had 3 goals, 4 assists in the last 8 games, and Pacioretty's going to the dressing room.
hasn't gone longer than four games without a goal all season long.
Yeah, he's been remarkable. Remember, he had 39 last year, so he's following it up. And right off the draw, we're going to get a high sticking call here. Oh, boy, the Panthers putting themselves in trouble after the 5-on-4 tough call with a high sticking here to make it a 5-on-3.
Number 44, Florida, 2 minutes, high sticking.
You know, we talked about the improvements that are going to be needed for next year. There are a lot of very good signs. Take a look at the top of your screen here. The stick that's right under the chin of Gallagher. And, you know, there's really no doubt about that. One of those improvements is taking penalties.
5-on-3, Subban up high. Plekanec puts it in front, knocked away. Mitchell and Petrovic and Bolin, the three for Florida. Galchenyuk swings it back over to Gallagher. And now it's Markov. He and Subban can shoot that puck. They'll need Ellis to come up big here. He's off to a strong start. Plekanec and Subban play catch. Now the pass, the shot stopped by Ellis on Subban. And Boland able to clear. That's huge. The Panthers will get some new penalty killers out there. Huge moment early in this hockey game. Galchenyuk down the wing. Here's Markov. Plekanec scores. He banks it in from the goal line. Power play goal for Montreal.
Well, not so dissimilar than the game-winning goal when Pacioretty scored on a very similar play in Montreal. And again, it was a power play. That one overtime, 4-on-3. Very tough to defend against because, you see, there are really three targets. The two Canadians on the ice in front of the net for Plekanec. And then the other target is shoot it at the goaltender. And that's what Plekanec did. He had all those targets, and they were open for a little bit of time, but just too many people to cover for the three defenders.
200 career goals for Thomas Plekanec. He's been steady Eddie. One of the most consistent players in the league.
And they stay on the power play here. It's a 5-on-4. So the call on Kulikov was a tough one as Pacioretty went down hard. And then the high stick on Gudbranson just 3 seconds after the 5-on-4 started. And the Panthers are now down a goal, and they need to get out of this. I think Plekanec is one of the more underrated players in the NHL. He's been in Montreal for a while.
Not underrated by his any coaching staff that's been there. I remember talking to Pierre Grou. Remember Pierre Grou?
Yep.
He was here for a while as goaltending coach and then went to Montreal and couldn't stop raving about his work ethic.
And those that watch him every day, for sure he's not underrated. But the average fan, you talk about your better centers, and his name doesn't come up all that much. But no, 20 goal a year for him.
You're absolutely right.
I had a chance to play with him in the minors in Hamilton. Right when he was starting, you could see the talent was there right from the start at both ends of the rink. He had it. Much like Alexander Barkov can play both ends. Thomas Plekanec came in, thought defense first, and then built up that offensive reputation.
He didn't stay long there with you in the minors, did he?
Not very long at all. Just that run in the playoffs. He was up next season. Yeah. We went all the way to the Calder Cup Finals and lost in Game 7. He was a big part of that team, but I think it was the next year that he made the Montreal Canadiens.
Yeah, I heard he had asked to get moved very quickly.
So they get one goal in the 5-on-3. And now we're even strength to see if the Panthers can gain a little momentum here. Trocheck for Hayes. Handcuffed him, though. Hayes feeds it up high. Campbell's shot. Oh, and it broke his stick in half.
I tell you what, I think that Campbell may have done Eller a favor. Boy, Eller went down to block the shot, and I think he missed the timing.
Turnover here. Plekanec throws it down below, but Galchenyuk missed the net well wide. And Ekblad covering the front of his net. Good effort, but it's knocked down again by Plekanec. Galchenyuk climbs into the slot, looking for an opening, throws it wide. And Yager chips it ahead. Through Huberdeau, though. And an offside call on the Canadiens. Montreal's broken out on top with a two-man advantage. The goal by Thomas Plekanec. About midway through the first, and the Canadiens on the power play, Billy, have cashed in, and they have the lead.
for the Panthers, if you want to talk about the future of this hockey club and what's going to happen and the young growth of the development, well, all these young Panthers have had career highs in points, starting with Jonathan Huberdeau, 51 points on the season. Jimmy Hayes set a new career high in points, along with Alexander Barkov. Nick Bjugstad, 24 goals on the season. That's a career high. Brandon Peary, 22 goals. And you look at all those numbers and those career highs for all these players, they're going to continue to get better. I think those numbers will improve next year, along with Aaron Ekblad, the rookie. I think he'll have a stronger season. So the future is starting to really materialize. It's here, and it's going to be in full form next season for the Panthers. And Denny, with those Plekanec comments, you missed one game. You're taking shots at me already. Unbelievable.
I heard Goldie last night.
Floodgates are open. We only got a few more broadcasts to get it all out. Yeah, and you know, these veteran players as well, you got to give them a lot of credit. You know, those that were here, those that have been brought in, you see Okunin, Willie Mitchell, Mackenzie Thornton, really setting the stage and the work ethic for this team. But, you know, as you joined us in Panthers Live pregame, talked to Aaron Ekblad down on the bench, and he said, hey, you know, and this is what Willie Mitchell's been preaching, and he's living with Willie Mitchell. And Ekblad said, basically, hey, that game in December, January, the 30th game, the 35th game, and there are the roomies right there. It means just as much as game number 77 against the team you're chasing, and you really got to realize that. And I would think next year they will.
You know, you talk about those one-goal games, those losses, and some of the games that the Florida Panthers were in there maybe should have won. You know, there are 22 of those in the first 40 games of the season. So the Florida Panthers know what the MO is for next year, and that is, for the guys who want to have a good season, you've got to have a good October. You've got to have a good November. If you're going to have a good season, don't forget those months. You know, there was a time when, before the cap and all that stuff, coaches and general managers used to actually give bonuses to players. And Billy, you can comment on this because you were there for 10-game segments.
Mm. Yeah, they had some 10 games. Some did 5 games, right?
Yes,
if you reached a certain
games,
amount of points.
Whatever it was. And if you were in the positive category, each player would get a bonus.
We had that, exactly. Roger Nielsen had that when we started. We loved that check. He used to get a $600 check if you started out, and a little rough stuff going on. But, yeah, that was some good spending money. It would go a long way with you, Goldie.
Yeah, well, just ask your wife. She must have spent it all. I don't think you saw a piece.
Welcome back to the BB&T Center. The Montreal Canadiens up 1-0 on the Florida Panthers. Habs goalie Carey Price leads the NHL in most goaltending categories. Wins, save percentage, goals against average, shutouts. But when you look at his other number, very important number, goals of support per game, he's tied for 24th in that. Just 2.68 goals per game of support. So he's had to be that good, guys.
That's a very good point, because the Montreal Canadiens are not bringing an onslaught of offense to the playoffs. So he is going to have to continue to be that good.
And for Montreal, Max Pacioretty went hard into the boards. His head slammed into the wall, and he left earlier in the game. And he's not returned yet. After about 6 minutes into the game, Dan Ellis will make a save here. Good Branson clearing the slot. Oh, he got shaken up on that play, too.
You know what? I think that Gallagher is a little sturdier than Good Branson thought. And I think when he came in to push him, I think Gallagher had his shoulder right in the middle of his chest. Or let's see what happens to the stick. Oh, wow. Yep, that's a good reason right there to sort of lose your breath a little bit.
That's tough.
And should have been called, actually.
Offside here as the Panthers try to run in. Gudbranson shaking it off.
It's a man's game. That's why it should have been a call. I know what he's thinking. I got his number.
Vinny Trocheck down low. Working with Brandon Peary here. Fed up the boards. Kulikov put some pressure on. And the Canadiens, though, able to get out. De La Rose, the 19-year-old, sends it deep in the Panther zone. Petrovic uses the body to try to fend off Brandon Prust. And Peary gives the Trocheck. Geary bearing down on Tom Gilbert, but he's able to move it along. Crust under pressure from Jágr. Panthers complete the line change. Huberdeau at the blue line. Double team and it's stolen away, but Jágr there to pick it up. Jágr, beautiful cross ice for Ekblad, puts it in front. Huberdeau couldn't get a stick on it. Oh, what a look by Jágr. And the Canadiens ice it. Well, don't miss the Panthers. Next home game, the Bruins are in town on Thursday night, and then the final game of the season, Saturday against the Devils, both here in Sunrise, 9-5-4-8-3-5. Puck fan appreciation night with plenty of giveaways Saturday night, so come on out for the end of the season.
Huberdeau, one thing he's shown me a lot in the second half is his strength. And on that last play, it doesn't happen unless Huberdeau puts a nice little pick and uses his body to get in front of Gilbert and open up the lane for that pass to Ekblad.
Do you think Jágr has taught him how to use his body in the offensive end?
Boy, Billy, that's a very good point. I tell you, I was just telling the French media over here, or the French broadcast, when they're asking me about Huberdeau, and I showed him exactly that. I said he's using his core, like his butt, the same way Jágr is, and they know exactly what we're talking about. He certainly has. And the fact that he's put on 15 pounds from last year. The strength has really benefited him in the corners. It benefits you if you can put it on. It benefits you from taking hits and giving hits. But look at this play. This is a real nice little move. Watch as 11 comes in. Yep, a little interference right there with Gilbert, and all of a sudden it opens up the lane, and the Florida Panthers get an opportunity, and it happens to be Huberdeau going directly to the net.
Jágr with 14 points in his 17 games as a Panther. There's his career numbers. He's played just about a full season against almost every team in the Eastern Conference throughout his career. It's remarkable.
That's one of my favorite things to do, is to look at the stats and see his career numbers against every team.
Well, Carolina, I think, is still number one. I think they went 41 goals in 82 games against them.
113 points or something like that, wasn't it?
Crazy. That was before the last time they played, the other night here, where he put up a couple more.
Listen, there were still 21 teams when he came in the league.
Oh, you could go back to when he came in the league. In fact, today, 24 years ago, Jaromír Jágr scored his first playoff goal in a Game 2 win for the Penguins over the New Jersey Devils. There was no such thing as the Florida Panthers when that game was played. I mean, it's remarkable how long he's been doing. He really is. Trocheck speeding in. Price moves it along, though.
Well, it's a great credit to his determination. And, Billy, you talked about that last night. The fact that he dedicated himself to a much better physical program, something he did rely on in his early career.
Trocheck had a collision with Jimmy Hayes right in front of me, and Trocheck went to the bench very gingerly.
Kulikov battling here down low. Weiss for Prust. And Weiss puts it right in front. And we'll get another penalty call here on the Panthers. Ooh, the third one already in the game on Florida. And Montreal will go back on the power play. Mark Gallant's team down a goal. Now they've got to go on the penalty kill. And for now, anyway, Vincent Trocheck went into the dressing room.
Well, you'll see what happens here. He runs into his own teammate, and he goes down hard. And all I can tell you is that it's a skeletal bruise of some sort. And then in front of the net, again, the mistake there is that Beery is going to need to have to stop. He's going to have to stop and take that check. What Brandon Beery has done there is a little bit on the lazy side. And those things don't go unnoticed, and that's probably what is being written down on the pad by Gerard Gallant. Brandon Beery was not in a perfect position as a left winger, but he was in a perfect position to cover the open Montreal Canadian player. And believe me, his centerman would have adjusted. So you never, never leave that area of the ice open. The Panthers have done that already a couple of times in this game.
Markov set up off the faceoff. Kopetsky pressuring Subban. Canadians hold it in the zone. Smith-Pelly getting some rare power play time.
They're trying to get him going for the playoffs. He's done nothing in terms of production for the Panthers since the trade.
Yeah, they got him from Anaheim. Here's Desharnais putting it in front. Skips around the boards. Markov, it's blocked and then cleared by Kopetsky. Pacioretty left early in the game. He hit his head into the boards. The high-scoring Canadiens winger.
Yeah, I meant obviously the Montreal Canadiens there if I misspoke. Must be the high fever I have right now.
I had that cold, Denny. It was brutal, man.
Oh, gosh, I tell you. Nasty.
And battling through it. Give you a lot of credit.
Desharnais is in. The pass stolen away by Jussi Jokinen. Oh, boy. That was close. Boy, these power plays, guys, how they turn this game. First 5 minutes even. Jágr had that great chance, and then penalties taken by the Panthers, and it's been all Montreal since.
Well, like we were talking before, Goldie, you know, the early part of next year, Gerard Gallant will have known his team a lot more, will have set certain rules, and being much more disciplined is going to be a big one right from the beginning of the season.
Petrie now up at the point. Plakanec throws it down low. Galchenyuk trying to walk out in front. Kulikov got a piece of it. Loose in front. Ellis is down. Can he find it? And he does. And now Petrovic going at it with Gallagher and Kulikov in there as well. Bolin grabs Plakanec. Great overhead look at the scrum.
Hey, if you want to get back at somebody, now's the time.
Yeah, Petrovic with the smooth face wash there. Bolin having some words with the official.
Yeah, I don't think Gallagher wants to tangle with Petrovic after Petrovic had that fight in Montreal.
Against Tenorti.
But Gallagher, it's tough to move him out. I tell you what, he is a solid little fire plug that will stand in the crease. One could certainly argue that he had early contact with the goaltender Ellis before he went down. Now, these are going to be things that are discussed over the summertime by the NHL general managers, seeing if there's more they could do to help protect goaltenders.
Well, in Dan Ellis's case this year, in the 8 games he's played for the Panthers, what more they can do is call the rule as it's currently written. I mean, he guys been run over numerous times. I don't know if it's, you know, hey, he's the guy called up or whatever the case is, or it's just coincidence, but Dan Ellis hasn't had any goalie interference calls in his 8 games. They've bumped him and banged him down pretty good. Panthers kill it off here. McKenzie throws one over the net. Big Carom loose in the circle. Peary out of the box. But the Canadians have it at center.
Well, I could have him call Billy Smith to find out what to do to gain respect.
Chopping across the legs. He was mean. He was the meanest goaltender, I think. Him and Ron Hextall, probably the two meanest goaltenders to ever play the game.
Yeah, the old, you know, don't take the law into your own hands. Billy Smith did not subscribe. Huberdeau for Jágr. Jágr so smooth, holding on. Looking for an open man. Jager's still with it. Campbell throws it in front. Huberdeau trying to stuff it in, but Carey Price is able to cover up for the Canadians. Fox Sports Supports is teaming up with the Boys and Girls Clubs of America to help promote young people reaching their full potential. Programs that promote character, leadership, education, and more. For more information, visit foxsportssupports.com.
Well, it doesn't take a trained eye to figure out that the Barkov line is trying to lead by example. And the Panthers have just got to follow so that they can upgrade their game to the level of the Barkov line.
Russ plays it in over the Panther line. Torrey Mitchell speeding it after it. He fell down. Trocheck, good to see him back out there after leaving briefly after that collision with Big Jimmy Hayes. Ekblad throws it out to center, but Mitchell pops it right back in the Panther zone as we get late on here in the first period. Thomas Plakanec on a 5-on-3 advantage, the only goal.
This is good, considering the amount of penalties the Panthers have had already.
Yeah, 3 power plays for Montreal, no question. Now Campbell Blocked. Kulikov on the line. Keeps it in. Here's Hayes. Stolen away. Trocheck picks it up. A chance here. They float it over the net. Campbell didn't quite get all of it, and then it was deflected. A couple of good shifts in a row by the Panthers, putting some pressure on. And Hayes down the wing. Hayes takes a shot. That goes wide. Kulikov jumps up after it. Barkov. Huberdeau. Huberdeau gets grabbed. Barkov picks up the puck. How strong he is. Barkov working down low. Jágr joins in. Jágr with Barkov. Jágr's got it. Jágr's still with it. Try to get it up to the point. Knocked down. Huberdeau joins the scrum. Penalty finally coming up on the Canadiens. A delayed call. Look at the work by Jágr. Tries to get it to Huberdeau. Oh, they'll say the Canadiens got the possession there, so we do get the whistle. And, Denny, that was 3-4 hardworking shifts in a row.
Montreal penalty, 26, 2 minutes, okay.
Well, now the Florida Panthers get a chance. You know what they used to say, bend it like Beckham? Well, why don't you protect it like Jágr? How about Huberdeau? That's using his size. That's using part of what you were talking about, Billy. Huberdeau learning stuff from the veteran Jágr.
So first power play of the game for the Panthers after Montreal's had three.
Well, this would certainly balance things pretty well in the favor of the Panthers, killing off a couple of major penalties and then being able to score on your first power play.
They win the battle off the faceoff to get set up. This is Peary. Owns 22 goals, 7 of them on the power play this year. Peary fires cross ice. Bolin in front for Jokinen. Couldn't get a good shot off, and Hayes did it. Stopped by Price. Jimmy Hayes gives to Brian Campbell with speed. Campbell is in on a pass deflected, a little blind drop pass, and it's sent all the way down.
What's getting there, the Montreal Canadiens at the top of the league, top of their division, and into the playoffs is how well they support one another in their defensive game. Wow.
And look at that, skipping right along the goal line. If Peary would have gotten the goal that way, all bets would have been off.
You'd have to sort of say, kind of like Mario Lemieux in 94, 5 goals in a game in 5 different circumstances.
Amazing.
Really amazing.
Barkov gets hit. Kulikov picks it up and shoots. That went wide.
I think that may have gotten the outside of the goalpost.
Power play will carry over. They don't score before the period ends. Here comes Kulikov. Back for Barkov, but it doesn't connect. They've got to wait for everyone to get onside here. And that'll do it for the first period. Canadiens get the only goal. 5-on-3 goal by Thomas Plekanec, said it's 1-0 after one.
Not much missing. The Panthers have played pretty well in killing off those penalties. They're just one goal behind. Sharpen your edges for the second period. Panthers have got to be a little sharper. That's it.
End of one. We go down to the Miami Brewing Company Beer Garden. Andrew.
Goldie, thank you very much. Coming up on the Lexus Intermission Report, we're going to take a closer look at Panthers defenseman now playing as a forward today, Stephen Kampfer. Both will hear from him and have a story on his road to the NHL. Plus, we'll take a look at the youth, the young core of this Florida Panthers team, and all of the highlights and analysis of the first 20 minutes of play. The Montreal Canadiens managed to beat Dan Ellis with a power play goal by Thomas Plekanec. It is a 1-0 game as the Cats will start the second period on the man advantage. The Lexus Intermission Report is coming up. Don't miss it. All the highlights, stats, and more fun right after this.
We get set to start the second period, and the Panthers will be on the power play for half a minute to begin the period. Their first power play of the game. Montreal, Denny, big story in the first. They got the goal on a 5-on-3 man advantage.
Well, the Florida Panthers a little undisciplined, but usually because of miscues leading to the Florida Panthers having to take penalties. But overall, I think the Florida Panthers were not as sharp as you would like them to be in the first period. We're going to show you a play that kind of epitomizes what's happened. It sometimes is just a little bit of lack of communication. When you see here, the pass Campbell to Ekblad, and it gets missed. So the puck goes in the zone. Montreal, a lot of puck possession. And when he comes back to the bench, Gerard Gallant is not saying anything critical. He is pointing out what happened and the result, and not trying to take any confidence away from young Aaron Ekblad. It wasn't just his fault. Communication by the defenseman. So there was a little bit of that throughout the first period, and several of those, the lack of communication led to penalties.
So the Panthers will try to cash in here on the power play that carries over. There's a look at Ekblad with the 11 goals this year as an 18 and a 19-year-old turned 19 February.
What a great time to be sharp to start the second period on the power play.
Kulikov's got it. And the shoot-in, bouncing in front. Played over to the boards. Lechenya taken away by Huberdeau. Got a little pass there, knocked down by Mitchell. But Jágr, stolen by Gilbert. Cross, pressured by Kulikov. Ekblad with a great hold-in. Keep the play alive. Barkov, Jager's in front. He shoots. Oh, what a big glove save by Carey Price on Jágr.
Anybody doubting that he will win the Vezina? How about the most valuable player? These are the kinds of saves that really lift a team. I mean, this is just unbelievable. And the guy that's shooting the puck, by the way, has like 1,700 points in the National Hockey League. Carey Price is on target.
So the power play ends as Price makes that save. And the Canadiens' lead remains at 1-0. Galchenyuk on that wing with Plekanec in the middle and Gallagher on the right. Galchenyuk stepping up out of that wing, and a penalty here on Jokinen. Oh boy, tough call there.
Come on.
I was going to finish and say that we haven't seen Max Pacioretty back in the game after hitting his head into the boards early in the first, but Jokinen does not like that call at all. It's the fourth already today on the Panthers.
Number 36, Florida, tripping.
Well, he doesn't even have enough penalty minutes to equal his number on the season. That is...
He checked him.
That's not tripping, folks.
I don't know where the trip is.
Yeah, that's not tripping.
Wow.
And that's a little stale here, you know?
Fourth power play of the game for Montreal. And cleared out to center. The Panthers were a bit frustrated by some of the calls in the game in Montreal last weekend. Canadiens won it in overtime on a power play goal. Fourth power play already in this game. Galchenyuk slides it over to Markov. Back for Galchenyuk, but it was behind him. He'll peel back to the point. Gallagher out in front of Dan Ellis, Panther goaltender here.
Boy, a lot of movement on that Montreal power play. They're 10th best in the NHL coming into the game tonight. You know, the reason why it creates a better power play with movement is that we always talk about the lanes, the passing lanes that you want to open up for yourself while on the power play. And of course, when there's a lot of movement, you're bound to open up more lanes more often.
We get an icing call on the Canadiens while up a man. Now the Panthers have had a great turnaround season, and I know many folks, including the players, chomping at the bit for next year, and you can be here at the BB&T Center. Flexible ticket plans are available. Lower bowl packages as well. Start as low as $25. Call 954-835-PUCK. Ticket reps are standing by. Subban back behind his own net, starting to lead the rush here. See if the Panthers can get out of this. Montreal, all kinds of power play chances early in this game. Boland out at center, causing some problems. Markov throws it in the zone. Kulikov held it at the point. Subban with a wrister. Saved by Ellis with Kelly Smith right in front of him.
.400 games with the Montreal Canadiens alone. Michel Therrien. You know, it's not that easy in Montreal to find a coach. First of all, it's got to be French most of the time anyway. And Michel Therrien has been a terrific coach for them these last several years. And again, has gotten the team at the top of the division. Yet there are still some media in Montreal that will say if they don't do well in the playoffs or win the cup, his job may be at stake. Tough business.
They've got Petrie up at the point now, along with Gilbert, the two defensemen. Placanitz for Petrie. There's the one-timer. It goes wide. It carries all the way out. Kopetsky looking to track it down. Kopetsky moves in. Throws it in front. McKenzie couldn't get a deflection, and he goes down hard.
Well, he threw himself to get away from Carey Price.
Odd man rush the other way as the power play ends, and Kopetsky with a steal. Jokinen lead pass. It's Trocheck. Petrie is back. Trocheck holds. Finds an opening and shoots. It's blocked away and out of play off Galchenyuk's skate.
That's where Trocheck got his goal from the other night. Good wrist shot from the high slot. There you just get the break. Florida Panthers trying to get the puck to the front of the net. There's McKenzie doing his best to stay away from contact. And Trocheck must have remembered the two-goal night he had, because one of them came right from that spot.
Five-on-five hockey. Haven't seen a ton of it so far early in this game. A little more than 23 minutes gone by. Placanitz, the only goal, came early in the first on a two-man advantage. Canadians win this faceoff. They're about 50-50 so far in this game in the circle, these teams. Hayes tips to the head for Brandon Peary. Slides it to the middle, but it's broken up. Hayes again. Gets it deep in the zone. The hit there by Peary. Ekblad steps down the wall. Yemelin trying to get free, and he does. Hayes again makes his way to center ice. Lead pass up on the wing, but it did not connect.
No, that's about three soft passes that I've counted between the blue lines. That's a neutral zone. You just don't want to turn the pucks over.
Subban got a puck right in the face there. Hopefully he's okay. It looks like he is.
You know, sometimes the puck gets underneath that face shield, and it can really do a lot of damage. There was a player, I can't remember, Goldie, maybe you saw it, but I think it was with the Winnipeg Jets. The puck actually was deflected up underneath his face shield and stayed there.
Yeah, it got stuck. I saw that a couple days ago.
There you see the intended deflection into the zone. That's a planned play. That's part of how you enter the zone. And there you see the direction of the puck going right into PK Subban's face. But fortunately, he's still not on the ice, is he? Or?
Yeah, he went into the dressing room.
Yeah, so
assuming
I suspect that he'll be back, yep. But that was flush.
Pacioretty has not come back, unfortunately,
right,
after banging his head into the boards. Barkov on a loose puck. Tucks it out in front. Jágr at the goal line. Tries to get to the forehand, couldn't. And this puck deflects and goes out of play.
This Montreal team, I think, would have trouble getting anywhere without Max Pacioretty and with PK Subban.
Oh, boy.
They definitely wouldn't go anywhere. So I think Subban will be okay to come back, but Max Pacioretty right now, they don't know the condition of him. If they lose their top goal scorer going into the playoffs, that is really going to hurt the Canadiens' chances. They're only 22nd in the league in goals per game.
Well, I tell you, I mean, they're 1-2 in the scoring for the Montreal Canadiens. Huge on their power play.
Desharnais gets free with a nice move, but a good poke check by Petrovic. And here comes Barkov. Huberdeau trailing. The give to Huberdeau. Back to Barkov. Tries to tuck it in front, but nobody there.
Oh, now that's a little overdone. That's like burnt toast right there.
And now Lars Eller goes the other way for Montreal. Jágr slows him down.
At some point, the puck's got to go to the net.
Smith-Pelly. Yemelin up high. Throws it in front, knocked down and taken away by Barkov, leading a 3-on-2. Jágr now at the line, cuts to the middle, has Kulikov jumping up, saved by Price. Kulikov on the rebound, trying to find it, but Eller able to clear for the Canadiens.
That hit part of Carey Price's mask, and I think that there's something broken on it, maybe. Could be a strap. That hit him right in the face, that shot by Kulikov. Kulikov can shoot the puck pretty well on a wrist shot. And I heard it, and immediately I saw Carey Price go for his helmet. Now, fortunately, again for Montreal. Could you imagine that, Billy? Oh, my gosh. Pacioretty, Subban, and Carey Price. Now, unfortunately, they're all, well, we're assuming they're all fine. Certainly, Carey Price, we can tell for sure.
P.K. Subban back on the Montreal bench now after taking that puck up in the face.
Well, there's another one there.
Dan Ellis will cover up.
P.K. Subban, second overall in scoring for the Montreal Canadiens. Second overall in scoring on their power play. And he leads the Montreal Canadiens in power play goals. So there you have it.
See the little cut there. He's asking his teammate, am I bleeding? Now that he can't handle. Boy, what an exciting player he is to watch.
He's only going to get better and better. Had some things he had to get over. A little overzealousness at times. Try to beat the last man. Try to make plays in the zone when an easy pass would have been a better choice. All those things you learn as you play.
Puck goes out of play in the Panther zone.
This is not going to help Michel Therrien's attitude towards his team's power play. The Florida Panthers right now have given up four power plays, and the Montreal Canadiens have not been able to capitalize the way Therrien would look like. They had six power plays against New Jersey in their last outing, only was able to get one power play goal. Bottom line is, they've been getting a lot more power play chances than they've been able to convert.
Kopetsky tucks it out in front and gets to the net. McKenzie is there. Campbell over to Ekblad. Kopetsky put it right in front, and then Sean Thornton took a swipe at it. Kopetsky again puts it in front of the net. Gail Weiss able to clear, and let's see, did this puck go straight out? I think it did. I think it's a penalty on Weiss for a delay of game call. The Panthers will have a power play when we come back. 1-0 Montreal on a power play goal in the first, a 5-on-3. Billy, the Panthers will get a power play chance coming up.
And the Panthers' power play has been really good since the All-Star break, since they went to that four-man rotation. And that's what they need. If the Panthers are going to get in the playoffs, they need their power play to pick it up next season. Take a look at Gerard Gallant on the season. The Panthers' power play is ranked 27th in the National Hockey League. Their penalty kill, 23rd. I think you need to get that power play up around that 15 to 20 mark, and that penalty kill up into the top 10 or 15. But you want those numbers to add up to over 100%. Right now it adds up to 95%. If you're under 100% combined on those two numbers, then it's not good enough. So those two areas have to improve next season.
And I bet you they will. Just by judging how Barkov, how Huberdeau has played, how Peary.
Ekblad walks in, hammers one and scores!
Got a chance to get to number five, Aaron Ekblad. How they will be able to contribute on the power play as well as even strength all of next year. And of course the key is winning the faceoff. Everybody got involved. You notice how I believe all three forwards had a hand in getting the puck back to Ekblad. Again, these are team goals. This is where everybody fights to get the puck to the player who is most capable to get a scoring chance. And it was beautifully handled right here by the Panthers, putting it on the stick of Ekblad, who scores his 12th goal.
And good work by Huberdeau, helping out right off the faceoff to get it set up. And now we're back even again. Dan Ellis with a save there. Gallagher down low. Ellis gets barreled over again. Tag with Dan Ellis. He's okay, and here comes Huberdeau. Let's it go through to Jágr. Jágr cuts in. Shot was blocked. Jágr's on it again. Leaves for Barkov. And Huberdeau digs it free. Petrovic with a slap shot. It got through. It stayed out. Huberto! Oh, Petrovic threw one on net. He had twice beat. And the Canadians clear. And look out, Subban! Trying to catch up to the puck. It's picked up now. Out in front, they score! Gallagher! So close one way, and then the goal the other way. It's 2-1, Montreal.
You want to see not listening? You're going to see it right here by Kulikov. Could have been 2-1 right there, no doubt about it. Kulikov, okay, is being told by Yager, right here, by Yager, stay to the front of the net. I'm going to get the puck carrier. Stay in the dangerous area. He pointed to Kulikov, stay in front of the net. Kulikov let himself be drawn towards the puck carrier, and that's where Gallagher got to the front of the net all by himself. Oh, my.
Just 46 seconds after the Panthers get it tied. Petrovic inches away from the lead. But it's Subban making that pass to Gallagher. And now a turnover by the Panthers and another chance. But Gudbranson makes a super play to lay down. Here comes Petrovic. Trocheck throws it in the zone. Hayes with a good hit on Yemelin. Trocheck with a steal. Peary's in front. He just misses wide, though. Oh, if there's one guy you want to see all alone in front of that net, it's Brandon Peary.
Boy, he had a little zip on that. It was shooting off the wrong leg, but he put all he had into it.
We got a game now. Stoppage with an icing calls. They've exchanged goals in the second.
Well, Dimitri, you'll see this replay and just learn from it. Watch right here. Yager turns to him and basically says, stay to the front of the net. Watch Yager's reaction here. See with the left hand? I told him to go to the front of the net. And Kulikov just got drawn into the puck carrier, which is a major mistake a lot of defensemen will make.
First four meetings of the season between these teams. Three have gone overtime, all decided by a goal. Right now it's Gallagher's goal, the go-ahead. One for Montreal here in the second. Camphor on the forecheck. And they throw it all the way down. No icing, though. Canadians will get a line change here. It's Bolin with Camphor up front and Jokinen. Brian Campbell gets by three Montreal players. Jokinen on the wing, try to shovel it in front. Knocked down by Gallagher. Plekanec for Gallagher. And back again, the return feed. Scooped up by Markov. Oh, Ellis got a piece with the glove and then swatted it out of harm's way.
I thought Brian Campbell might have been able to walk right into the net. It looked like the Montreal defensemen were playing him wide.
Gallagher again works a free puck, but then it's taken by Kopetsky. Kopetsky trying to fight through a couple of checks. Markov hit by Thornton. Galchenyuk up the wall. Petrovic, nice job getting a piece to keep it alive in the offensive zone. Kopetsky shovels it down low again. The Ekblad goal for the Panthers from Huberto and Barkov. Couple more points for those two. Alex Petrovic jumping up, throwing one on net from the sharp angle. Pass saved by Price.
For Ekblad, his first goal in 15 games. Every point's going to help his case for his Calder Trophy nomination.
Well, he had been quiet offensively for the last couple of weeks.
The grind of the NHL schedule, that's tough on an 18, 19-year-old kid when you get this late in the season, that first go-around.
Yager gives to Barkov, cutting in. Barkov centering pass. Huberto finds it, shoots, it's blocked. Bouncing in front. And now over to the wall, Gudbranson throws it in front of the net. Cut off there by Mitchell. Yager knocks it free. Yager and Huberto working. They get it to Barkov. Gudbranson, open man. Willie Mitchell, slap shot saved by Price. And there's no rebound. Here in the second, Aaron Ekblad tied it. But moments later, Montreal's Brandon Gallagher for the lead.
Welcome back to the BB&T Center Fan Street to a back-and-forth game. It's 2-1 Montreal here in the second. Just two home games left for the Florida Panthers this season after tonight. And on Saturday, it is Fan Appreciation Night. The Panthers are giving away over $50,000 worth of prizes on Fan Appreciation Night, April 11th against the New Jersey Devils. There'll be signed sticks, pucks, and jerseys, Beats by Dre headphones, hotel giveaways, big screen TV. Go to floridapanthers.com or call 954-835-PUCK. Reps for standing by, so call now, guys.
Sounds good. Look forward to it on Saturday. By the way, Max Pacioretty, who left the game in the first, will not return. Here comes Bolin. Couldn't get a shot off, though. Waited a little too long, and Mitchell on the back check took it away. So Pacioretty, his head, fortunately, hit into the wall, and he will not come back tonight. That's the only report. Here comes Camphor, two on two with Bolin. Jokinen, wraparound attempt once and twice, and Price able to make the pad save. Bolin with a steal. Petrie takes back for Montreal. Entertaining play here in the second period. Two goals coming just 46 seconds apart. Ekblad to tie it, and then Gallagher off the feed from Subban. Save there by Ellis, but the big rebound, and Parenteau puts it in.
I'd have to say this is quite unbelievable. Probably in the lower 5% of the NHL of skating ability, Parenteau is left alone not only to travel through center ice, but then to get his own rebound. I mean, it's not a great rebound, definitely off a wrist shot. Dan Ellis has handled rebounds better. But oh my goodness. P.A. Parenteau, who is really fighting for his life, for respectability for his coach, having not contributed very much offensively, seven goals on the season. Looked like a superstar on that one.
Both defensemen turned their heads to go back and look for the puck. As soon as they did that, they lost sight of P.A. Parenteau. And the puck was right in the middle of the slot. He picked it up and put it in the middle of the net. Preferably, you'd like one defenseman to stay with Parenteau.
I mean, you know, granted, Dan Ellis can handle rebounds better than that. But you have to expect that you're not allowing a player to get a second shot, no matter where the rebound goes.
Unfortunate there for Kulikov and Petrovic.
Is that steam on Gerard Gallant's head? I think so.
Hayes has a chance, but never got the shot away. Hayes again puts it out towards the front of the net. Peary took a swipe at it, played to the boards, and then it cleared out to center. So after the Panthers got it tied on the power play, the Canadiens with 2 5-on-5 goals to retake the lead.
You know, it's almost forgivable because you're playing the number one team in the division. But it's not forgivable when they are totally individual mistakes.
Vinny Trocheck with a chance. Ekblad in the slot. Gives to Hayes on the doorstep. They couldn't get the shot off, and then Hayes throws it in front and taken by Gallagher. Oh, my. Ellis has to cover.
Well, there'll be some work basically at recognizing who has the best piece of ice. And you know what the best pass in hockey is a rebound. And the Florida Panthers, three people touching the puck within 10 feet of the goal, and there's never a rebound created.
Hayes just ran out of real estate on the side of the net.
Well, he was the last guy to touch the puck, Billy, and he was in the worst position.
Right on side, nowhere he could go with that puck.
That's right.
Huberdeau gets in, centering pass, but it's taken by Galchenyuk. Willie Mitchell was jumping up there. Canadiens the other way. Ellis with a big save. Loose rebound. Gallagher throws it behind the net. Good. Branson takes away, but he's pressured by Plekanec. Markov takes a look, takes a shot wide.
Panthers better start stopping and starting in their own end. A lot of swinging going on.
Icing here on the Canadiens.
Well, there's one guy who's playing with a lot of emotion and motivation, and that's Dan Ellis, as he makes a big save here. Look at that, challenging the shooter. That's handling the rebound pretty well. And here's why. You know, the Florida Panthers, after Saturday, their season's over, but not for Dan Ellis. He's going to go join the team in San Antonio, who clinched the Calder Cup berth. First place in the West Division with 92 points. He's going to immediately step in to the number one role, most likely.
Goldie, what other Panthers are eligible? Is Camper and Petrovic and those type of players?
Camper would have to clear waivers with that 2-year extension, so I don't think they're going to take a chance on that. But Petrovic, Alex Petrovic have been down there most of the year. Vincent Trocheck for part of the year, so they can certainly both go back down. And by the way, Kyle Rau and Mike Matheson, who the Panthers signed, both played last night, and Kyle Rau scored a goal.
There you go. Mike Matheson, both he and Rau, captains of their team, character players, according to Brian Scrudland, who had some character when he played.
Right now, the Canadiens on top in the second by a pair. We get late on in the second period. Panthers were able to tie this game on the Ekblad power play goal, but then Montreal, a couple of defensive breakdowns, if you will, a little sloppy, and it's now a 3-1 game.
And it happened too quickly. It was like almost immediately after the Ekblad power play goal. Got them right back into the game, changed the balance of the game, and then really an error by Kulikov, who had been told, actually, just to stay to the front of the net by Jagr. He overplayed the puck carrier, and Gallagher snuck it behind.
Thornton, McKenzie, and Kopetsky on now for the Panthers.
That was what?
Ooh, and Price gets tangled up side of the net with Kopetsky and lost his helmet. Subban goes over to Kopetsky, and then Sean Thornton steps in. And you know Sean Thornton, whoever wants to chirp with him, that's fine. He's like, fellas.
Now the only one who's going to do that is Weiss, of course. I'm sure they've met a couple of times. Not a great period in terms of potential damage there to the number one goalie in the NHL. Wow. Ooh, that hurt. That must have hurt. We couldn't see that from our angle. This angle gives us a great view. What could have really been a stretch, stretching his neck.
Yeah, Kopetsky ran him over pretty good.
Yeah, and that was worse than what I had thought in the beginning.
Face-off win, Kulikov, the blast, blocked by Prust. Trying to shake that off, Prust is.
Well, I can see Montreal starting to wonder why there wasn't an interference call on that play.
Well, they let a lot go with the goaltenders being bumped around.
That's too many. Yeah, Dan Ellis has had to.
But now Thornton getting into it.
Similar fate.
With Weiss.
Let him go.
See, now here's a situation we talk about fighting. It's not a stage situation where there's nothing going on in the game.
Right.
Goaltender gets bumped. Canadians upset, as well they should be, with a guy that important. And this is where, if you don't just let them go, if they continue this way, this is when you're going to get somebody dangerously swinging the stick or something like that.
I couldn't agree more. I couldn't agree more. Or somebody runs a goalie again. Yeah, I tell you what, these guys are more on the ball than you can imagine, and they will take every inch of liberty that the referees will give them. And that's why, you know, earlier I talked about the offseason. There's going to be a lot of discussion, particularly about goaltender interference. There has to be.
It'll be interesting to see if the coach's challenge comes in next year. That's what
we're obviously the home broadcast with Goldie. You know, you and I are sitting here. There's no question Kopetsky should have been called for interference. I mean, that is major contact. And you're talking about the best in the league. I mean, there was a day when, you know, the Gretzky's and, you know, Lemieux and everything of the world, Trottier's, they would get protected a little bit by the referees or would get the calls. But obviously, times have changed so much that your superstar goaltender doesn't even get a nod.
Subban throws it all the way down the ice. Galchenyuk trying to catch up for the bouncing puck. It's offside, though, as it rolled into the zone. Coming up, MLB Whip Around starts Monday on Fox Sports 1. Tune in every weeknight for highlights, instant analysis, and live look-ins from around the league. It all starts Monday at 7 p.m. Eastern on Fox Sports 1 and streaming live on Fox Sports Go.
Fighting should and always have a place in hockey. The players have to be able to police themselves to some degree. I played in Germany where there was no fighting, and there was 5'5" guys just swinging their sticks violently at you. There was no repercussion, nothing that you could do against that. So I think if you have that fighting, always in the NHL to protect each other and to stick up for each other, it serves a value, and I think it always will.
I think guys in North America, Billy, we learned how to use our sticks from the Europeans. When I first played the Russians was first time I remember getting speared in the back of the leg as I'm going to get the puck in our zone. Now there are rules, obviously, against that with the new icing rule. But you're right, that was a standard.
I'll say something really bad happened between these two teams earlier in the season, and it wasn't solved. Now the playoffs are out for the Panthers, and it's in for Montreal.
Yeah.
And there was no fighting in the game. And you're a Panther player, and you wanted to get back at someone in Montreal without it fighting, and you wanted to do it, you could do it in a real cheap, harmful way. But if an incident had happened, you just went up to the guy, fought him, it would be put to bed.
Well, that's exactly what happened with Dmitry Kulikov, Tyler Seguin, and the Panthers and the Stars.
100%.
And it was over with. And it was done with.
Good
Kulikov knew was coming, fought.
Yeah.
End of story.
And Kulikov gave him a lot of respect.
Jágr with a shove there on Petrie, and now Parento steps in on Jágr.
This is where Parento should have his head buried. Please.
Montreal should want to stay away from this kind of game.
Yeah, they really should, yeah. Well, that's a pretty good hit there, but not dangerous. Well, maybe a little bit.
And those are some of the stuff when you're out of the playoff race that you will do. I mean,
yeah, well, listen, this is a frustrated Jágr because of the Gallagher goal. And he is seeing now, or we're all seeing now, that if there's one guy that may hold the edge in competitiveness in the Panther uniform, it could be Jágr.
Barkov, Jágr, Huberdeau on here. Subban, though, able to clear it to the point. Knocked down by Ekblad. It stays in the zone. But now Markov throws to center for Prust. Dale Weiss. Bouncing puck. Huberdeau's after it. Jágr up ahead. Good feed by Huberdeau. Jágr down the wing on Markov. Jágr pulls up. Feeds Huberdeau. Moves in front. It's Barkov. He tried a pass, though. Jágr in front. Behind Huberdeau. Oh, Barkov had a great look all alone in front of the net. Huberdeau stays after it, but it's cleared all the way down. It'll be icing on the Canadiens. Panthers may be guilty of just not shooting enough in this game.
Well, a lot of superlatives about number 16. But, folks, I can't analyze this play. I cannot analyze that play. I can't tell you why, which is my job.
Canadians will call timeout after the icing.
Tough. He's got a lot of work, Gerard Gallant, over the summer. I know he's got the scratch pad. He is going to go down the list, and we talked about many of the things the Florida Panther coaching staff will work on. They work on better discipline right towards the beginning of the season. So you don't take a lot of penalties. The Panthers have been a lot better the second half of the season. But you remember October, November, penalties taken 200 feet from the net while on a power play at times. You're going to work on definitely more pressure in the offensive zone, shooting the puck more. You're going to work on your power play. You're going to work on your penalty killing. Areas where the Florida Panthers are in the lower tier of the NHL.
And a lot of these young Panthers better not take this summer for granted.
Yeah.
They got to go home and work their tails off. And they got to be ready to go at training camp because it's going to be one heck of a competitive training camp when they get back.
Well, you know, the training camps these days, too, are not really training camps. I mean, you have about 3 days, then you start playing exhibition games.
Trocheck came back defensively to make the play after it looked like Montreal would have that odd man rush.
So coaches and players don't have a lot of time to learn new systems and to learn maybe a little bit of a tweaking on power plays and stuff.
Icing call, Panthers season seat holders. Don't forget, renew your ticket packages by tonight at midnight. That is the deadline. Get all those incentives. 954-835-PUCK. Make the phone call.
But I think we all agree it will be an exciting team next year.
Well, they made great strides this year.
Yep.
You know, so many games that were there either for the taking to win or get an extra point in some of them. I guess a lot of teams in the league can say that, but the Panthers were so close. Had some opportunities in February to either tie for that eighth spot or take over the lead and just fell short.
Well, you know, we talk about the early part of the season. We're not just banging on about it, because right now, if you look at these statistics.
Oh, a steal here in front, and Smith-Pelly scores. It's now 4-1 Montreal.
If you look at the statistics and the standings of everybody in the NHL, in the Eastern Conference, 7 of the 8 teams that were in a playoff spot at Thanksgiving are in the playoff spot now. Tough play here as the puck doesn't quite get to Willie Mitchell. He's going to feel badly about that. But again, the Florida Panthers having a tough time getting out of their zone, just letting the game slip away from them. Power play goal, it tied it at 1 in this period. But you know what? Sometimes teams that come back early after a goal being scored upon them, like we've seen the Panthers do many times, can quickly take control. Florida Panthers scored their power play goal at 6:20 of the second period at 7:06. Barely 45 seconds later, Gallagher scored to regain the lead for Montreal.
Really, really, really tough games to play emotionally after you've been eliminated. And I played in some of these games, and to get up and ready, you work so hard for one goal, the playoffs and everything, and then it just doesn't happen. The deflation that sets in when you go home after a game like that and you got to play the next night, it's tough to come back and rebound from that kind of disappointment.
You know, Billy, it happened last night. Colorado got 10 shots on goal in their loss to the Los Angeles Kings. 10 shots on goal. I mean, that gives you an idea of a team that's out of the playoffs, and they really did not give the LA Kings a lot of competition.
Now, I'm sure it's not an easy situation, there's no question. But
you find
you're a professional, you're getting paid, you're wearing a jersey, there's a logo on the front, there's a name on the back, and you got to find a way to bring it, don't you? I know it's tough to do.
Yeah.
And different, this is much easier for the younger players than the older veteran players.
Sure, the guys that have won the cups and they're, you know, used to being in those battles and playing where the stakes are so high, and it doesn't mean anything to them today. I understand that.
It's hard. And you are a professional, and you do try and show up the rink. You do your best. I honestly think these players showed up today to come out and play their best.
No question. But I think the effort's been there, yeah.
But there's a part of you that sinks.
Right.
And it's just natural. It's human nature to feel that way. And when you woke up this morning and you think, well, I have a game, and you got to go there, and you got to be professional. And these young players that are in the league fighting for their jobs and their lives, you got to go there and play hard. But players that have been around 10, 15 years, they know they're going to be in the league next season. It's a tough day to come to the rink. You try and do your best, but I'm just saying, from an emotional standpoint, I've been there.
There's got to be a letdown. Yeah, yes. There's no doubt.
And you don't want to make excuses.
You know, one of the things we talked about in the open is the fact that if you take a look at beating the Montreal Canadiens and the series against the Montreal Canadiens this year, you could conceivably say they are a big reason why we're not in the playoffs. They have stolen games, in a sense. One-goal games against the Montreal Canadiens. I mean, the series has been incredible. Florida Panthers could have won 3, all 4. and it's been that close, and maybe you create some emotion and motivation in yourself by simply saying, let's get back at these guys.
I think you'll see the Panthers play the last two games of the season pretty well. When they have these next three, 4 days off to digest everything, get back on the ice, and then regroup.
Campbell all the way in. Hayes went down, though. There's our next game. Panthers have a few days off. Bruins in town Thursday. And there's a good chance Boston is going to need to win that game. What a battle now in the East with the Penguins struggling so much, Detroit struggling, and there may be a team in the Eastern Conference in the high 90s that doesn't make the postseason. But in the second period after Aaron Ekblad tied the game, it looked pretty good for the Panthers. The Canadiens able to capitalize and get three straight goals for a 4-1 lead.
Florida Panthers have shown me one thing this year, and that is we won't be disappointed in this third period. They're going to come back, and they're going to give their effort to try and get back in the hockey game. The goal right now would be to go out and win the 20 minutes, get the first goal in the third period, and go from there.
Second intermission is coming up. We go downstairs to Drew.
Goldie, thank you very much. Coming up on the Lexus Intermission Report, we're going to go around the Eastern Conference and check out some scores and highlights from around the league today. Plus, we'll take a look at the Panthers' remaining schedule with two games left in the regular season. And we'll take a look at the projected playoff matchups as we stand right now for the National Hockey League. The Florida Panthers got the tying goal early into the second period by Aaron Ekblad, number 12 on the year, but Montreal, three consecutive goals after that, and it is a 4-1 game with 20 minutes left to be played here at the BB&T Center. Make sure you keep it right here. Lexus Intermission Report starts in just a couple of moments right here on Fox Sports Florida.
Teams getting back on the ice as we get set to start the third period. A game that was very manageable for the Panthers, especially after Aaron Ekblad tied in the second period. Panthers cashed in on the power play. Montreal's had more of the power play chances. But after that, Denny, some defensive breakdowns led the Canadiens open this game up.
You know, Goldie, I remember the 70s when Fred Shiro, who passed away now, when he was the coach of the Philadelphia Flyers, and he was telling a lot of people about these Russians. And one of the things that they really focused on is if you scored on them, the Russians came right back at you because they wanted to get a goal back right away. It's exactly what Montreal did, and I think that really got the balance going back in favor of the Montreal Canadiens again.
Yeah, it was that next shift after the Ekblad goal where Subban set up Gallagher. And a milestone reached on this day back in history. Yesterday, there it is, back in 1987.
Oh, my.
1,000 points. Wow.
Couldn't you just leave it at yesterday? No, that was a pretty great time, I tell you. We had a great hockey team, and you can imagine where a lot of the assists came from. Mike Bossy scored 50 goals, minimum, in each of his first 9 years in the NHL. That's still an NHL record, one that I can't imagine will ever be broken. So you had an idea that, for me, he was my Brandon Peary.
What a player he was.
Yeah.
You see Galchenyuk on the ice here on this line again. Max Pacioretty went awkwardly into the boards. His head hit the boards in the first period. He has not returned, and he will not return as we get set to start the third. Jágr was going at it with Galchenyuk right off the faceoff.
I saw Jágr show his edge a little bit late in the second period, certainly driven by some frustration.
Hey, Petrie, a little cross-check there. Jágr, Barkov, Huberdeau on the ice. The Panthers have been guilty a bit in this game of just not shooting the puck when they've had some looks. Overpassing. Jágr knocks it down, but it carries the center. Good Branson. Throws it in behind the net, and the Panthers go for a five-man change. Now it's Boland, Jokinen, and Hayes on the ice. Steven Kampfer started the game on that line on the wing. Kampfer, defenseman. Desarnais, centering pass. Shot was blocked. Kulikov, lead pass for Jokinen. It's got Hayes up on the wing, but the pass is knocked down.
tough to float one. Most players in the NHL, you know, it's not this great hand-eye coordination. They'll knock a puck out of the air anytime. Unless you make it a good, hard pass, you're bound to get intercepted.
Cross knocks it down along the boards. Fires up to the point, has Beaulieu with a shot, saved by Ellis. And he's able to find it with big Lars Eller right in front of him who went down.
So put you guys on the spot, give me some playoff predictions. Who you guys got for the Cup Finals in the East and the West?
Yeah, the NHL has got those old brackets out there and looking for everybody. First, Billy, let me go to a little comment by Goldie and Jager. Again, without having to say a word, you look at his stats. There's only two players on the Florida Panther team that have more shots per game than Jaromir Jagr. That's Brandon Peary and Bukestad. So again, without ever having him to say a word, just watch what he does.
He leads by example.
Yeah, exactly.
In front now, Gallagher in the backhand put it over the net. As for your question, I'm just not going to hem and haw. I'm going to go New York Rangers against the Nashville Predators. How's that?
I'm picking Nashville as well.
Well, you've been picking Nashville all year. I'll give you that.
He finally came over to my side. Interesting.
Yeah, you know, guys, I'm almost sickened to think that if L.A. makes it, they all of a sudden become a favorite again.
How'd you like to be Anaheim? You battle all year. You're probably going to get about 110 points. And what do you get?
Yeah.
Your rival, the Kings, in the first round.
I know.
Won two Stanley Cups in the last 3 years.
And I know Bruce Boudreau is scared to death about that. They had talked about, I guess it was in the Orange County News, I was reading it. One of the big things that he needs to have his team produce in the playoffs, not only wins, but power play efficiency.
Little conversation here, Gudbranson, Thornton, and Prost. And, you know, and I think in a series like that, and you talk about playing all year, like Kings, Ducks, if they play in the first round, throw away the home ice advantage. I mean, game seven, if it comes to that in Anaheim, flip the coin. The Kings could easily win a game like that. So Stanley Cup playoffs for me is the best postseason tournament in all of sports. But these guys go through night after night is just unbelievable.
How about the goaltender? New York Rangers with Lundqvist, Montreal, Carey Price, Ben Bishop in Tampa Bay. These are all teams that will definitely be favored in one way or another in the playoffs. Nashville.
How about a team under the radar, Washington, with their goaltender, Braden Holtby?
Oh, there's a deflection on goal. Good save by Price on Sean Thornton. And, yeah, Holtby's had a really good year. And, of course, Ovechkin, you know, so dangerous. Capitals have never been able to get over that hump over the last, you know, few years of when they made the playoffs.
As much as I hate to say it, Goldie, I don't disagree with your pick for the East.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's got to hurt.
Boy,
that's got to hurt to say that, doesn't it?
It's as nasty as the way I felt the last couple of days. I got to tell you, but I look at their speed. I look at their goaltending. Boy, a pretty good combination there for the New York Rangers. And probably an underestimated defense.
Oh, man, Jagr got a steal, but they're going to call a trip on Huberdeau on the same play behind the net. And it's going to be the fifth power play of the game for Montreal.
Well,
Mike, number 11, 2 minutes tripping.
Of course I say this in jest, but apparently the referee's pregame preparation was the same as mine. They read about how Michel Therrien feels that his team needs to improve on their power play. So give him a lot of opportunities. Starting to feel better.
They're 1-for-4. The one goal came at a 5-on-3 advantage early in the game. Here's a chance. Galchenyuk robbed by Ellis. The rebound. It's blocked by Kulikov. And then Ellis covers up with the blue paint.
I tell you what, it doesn't get any better than this. Galchenyuk had the puck in the prime spot. He really leaned into it. Watch, right in the middle of your screen. Look at this. Just leaning into it. Good save. Then he gets the rebound. Best pass in hockey. Another rebound by Gallagher trying to get it in the back door. You know, when you shoot the puck in the offensive zone, it's incredible how often it comes back to you. Because as you can see the Florida Panthers, you get turned around. You don't know where the puck's going or where it's going to end up. And half the players have their backs to the play. Certainly both defensemen in most cases.
Petrovic threw it out to center, but it's cut off by Subban. And the Canadians move right back in. Thomas Plekanec, he opened the scoring in this game on that power play in the first. Panthers added a 1-1 game in the second off the Ekblad goal, and then Montreal took advantage of some defensive errors to get three. Really can't fault goaltender Dan Ellis. Montreal has four, but on most of them, he's had absolutely no chance. Markov cross ice, Subban. Subban falls down, taken by Petrovic. No, he didn't fall down. They will get McKenzie for a trip. And, you know, Derek McKenzie's finally had enough. He doesn't bark very much at the officials, but boy, oh boy, six calls on the Panthers in this game.
Florida,
I mean, that's just frustrating. Frédéric Lucaille. Stick was on the skate. McKenzie thought he was falling down originally, but yeah, anyway, is what he thought.
The spinorama worked for
the stick was in
Subban
there, though.
And then McKenzie inadvertently ended up getting the stick between the legs. Yep.
So another 5-on-3 for Montreal. Desharnais puts it right through the slot. Boland able to push it down the ice. You know, some of these calls, like the Huberto call, I mean, that was a trip. You can't put yourself in position as well with the stick in the skates where if someone goes down and make it too easy on the officials to make the call. Petrie over to Gilbert now. The 5-on-3 winding down. Gilbert in front the pass. And the Canadians may be guilty of an overpassing a bit there.
Well, what you can see, which is really a credit to the coach Terrier, look at the five guys on the ice. I mean, this is there's not one of those guys that would normally be on a Montreal Canadiens power play, certainly not the first half of it. And that's a credit between coaches. You don't want to disrespect the coach. It's a 4-1 lead by Montreal. Terrier is not about to disrespect his colleague, Gerard Gallant.
And if I was a player playing in this game and I was a veteran player in the locker room, one thing I would have said before the game for motivation for myself and my teammates says we got Dan Ellis playing goal for us this evening. Yeah. He's done a heck of a job. We got to go out there and we got to perform for him.
Also because he's going to continue playing, right, Billy? He's going to go to Anaheim, to San Antonio.
That would have been my main focus.
Yeah, yeah,
I said,
I agree.
Dan Ellis has given us a chance when we were in there. Went down with our starting goaltender. He gave us a chance to stay in the playoff race. This is one player. Step out on that ice and do it for him this evening. He's competed at every step of the way that tonight. Some of the goals, like you said, you can't fault him at all. He's been given his A-plus effort. And that's what you would expect from the teammates in front of him.
Well, the penalty killers do the job here. McKenzie is back, but it remains a three-goal deficit against Carey Price.
I think this is the most goals he's given up, right? In any one game?
I think he had four in one other game.
Yeah. You can check on that, but the point is made, you know? You're right, Billy. I mean, you got to find a way. You got to find the ticket that motivates you.
Yeah, I'm standing corrected. Three was the most he has given up, so four
that was
the most.
That was to Montreal. Remember, the only two games he lost in regulation was that tough 3-2 loss to the Canadiens here and that 2-1 game to the Rangers in Madison Square Garden, the only two where the Panthers failed to get a point in Ellis's seven starts. And his starts really kept the season alive for the Panthers while Luongo was out. Dale Rose with a shot, Ellis the save. Brandon Peary out to center, picked up by Trocheck. Campbell's the trailer. Campbell gets the feed, throws it in front. Peary, though, just couldn't settle it down. Peary fights off Prust with a high stick. They let that one go. Campbell cutting in. It rolled on him, never got a shot away. Peary, he'll shoot. That's blocked away. Trocheck sets up Campbell. the shot blocker save by Price. Luckily for Crust, he's okay after taking that high stick. Here's Camford. Give it to Peary. Deflected by Yemelin. Panthers with a little pressure now. But Campbell flipped to the point, comes all the way back. Jaromir Jagr with speed. Jagr carries, cross-ice feed, Huberdeau. And then Barkov off his stick as well. Barkov's got it again, throws it in front. Jagr on the backhand save. Rebound, Huberdeau couldn't get to it. Glove down by Smith-Pelly, but Huberdeau's away. 3-on-2. He gives to Jagr. Barkov in the slot, gets the pass, takes the shot, and it's blocked. Boy, so many good looks and plays that look like quality scoring chances, but for one reason or another, many of the pucks never get to the goal. Jagr again, holding on. Off the bench, McKenzie races in. McKenzie banging there. Thornton picks up a loose puck. McKenzie again, stolen away though. Kulikov's pass forces Petrovic back. We're back with you again Thursday night when the Bruins are here in town. Still that big battle going on for the final playoff spots. And I use the plural in the Eastern Conference. Suddenly the Pittsburgh Penguins are in danger. The Red Wings are in danger of seeing that 23-year playoff streak end. This puck goes offside. And now a little frustration from Derek McKenzie. He'll settle down with Galchenyuk. We're in the third and the Canadiens are up by 3. No, Billy will take the pizza, but that young, he doesn't want the pizza. Not even paying it. I mean, Lindsay, you would
Where's the pizza?
You would never be able to sit there with that straight face with a slice in your face.
No,
impossible.
Not at all. You know, we enjoy our food. We also like our ADT defensive play of the game. That leads us into Eric Gabranson. On that play, Dave Parenteau picks up the puck. Gabranson, 2-on-1, lays down, sells out. Able to break up that pass. And Eric Gabranson, that's the kind of defense you're looking for from him. Dave Parenteau tried to elevate that puck, but Gabranson gets a piece of it. And where's the pizza at, Goldie? You got a slice up there in the booth? I know you got something up there. You brought a bunch of food to the rink yesterday.
We ate all the snacks, popping out a sandwich at the interim. What'd you have on that sandwich, by the way? Was that a little pizza?
Very healthy. Mustard, wow. A little turkey, okay. And brown bread.
No cheese?
No. All right. No cheese.
Oh, look. He delved in. Nice. See, no one can resist the delicious food as they enjoy it tonight here at the BB&T Center. But a tough sledding game for the Panthers. Down 4-1 to Montreal here. Midway through the third period. So, Denny, who do you think of these teams does not get in now in the East? I mean, Ottawa's still on the outside looking in. Yeah. 3 points back, but a win tonight, if they beat Toronto, pulls them 1 point behind the pack.
You know, I'm worried about Detroit. I mean, they've had a long grind. Every game's been important for a long time. And their goaltending has really suffered the last month and a half.
Well, they're trailing right now in to Washington 2-1. So if they lose this game, boy, oh boy, they stay at 95. Pittsburgh at 95. Boston at 95. And Ottawa can get to 94.
You talk about
injuries.
They win tonight. Pittsburgh, I mean, four of their top five defensemen are out with injuries. Obviously, Letang, they don't know what's going to happen, how long he's going to be out.
A couple of weeks ago, they had like a 9-point lead, and yeah, it seemed like a foregone conclusion. Two teams in NHL history have missed the playoffs with 95 points. Nobody's ever missed it with more than that. There's a chance somebody will in the East this year. Subban hammers one, it skips wide. Camper trying to run out of the zone, but he's stopped. Camper again does push it out to center. Here he gives to Trocheck. Trocheck, penalty coming up on Montreal as Price makes the save as Peary was taken down to the blue line.
Well, that'll be a tripping call right at the Montreal Canadiens blue line.
Panther power play coming up in the third. Devontae Smith-Pelly in the penalty box for a trip on Brandon Peary, and the Panthers will go on the power play for the third time.
There you see right there, a little back and forth, and there you see the skates coming out from underneath of Brandon Peary. Let me just retract there. I'm not saying this because I want Detroit to end this incredible run of 24 years in the playoffs. But I think that they've had difficulty getting some consistency in their game. And then, of course, that would knock Ottawa out, but Ottawa might do that on their own.
Yager with a shot, save, and then Barkov on the rebound. I'm going to call Barkov. I'm going to get a goalie interference here on Alexander Barkov. And I tell you, you know,
Florida penalty 16, 2 minutes goaltender interference.
Whether you agree with it or not, both goaltenders have been hit much harder in this game than this. And that's the thing about the consistency on the calls. Is there a slight contact there? Yeah, there's a slight contact, but Carey Price had his head twisted before, you know, around the goalpost earlier.
I know, exactly, with the goal. Kopetsky hit. Just to finish my thought, the reason why Ottawa might have a tough time, they, of course, play in Toronto tonight, a team that they always have trouble with. They play Pittsburgh, they play the New York Rangers, and then they play against the Philadelphia Flyers last game of the season. So they've got some pretty good teams that they have to beat, but they're in a position where they might need every point.
4-on-4 hockey now.
Goldie, that's something that the rest in the intermission might have talked about even, that with Carey Price. What happened? Did any of you guys see what happened on that collision where he got his mask knocked off? And they might have said, one lineman said, yes, he got ran over pretty good by Thomas Kopetsky. And then coming into this third period, it might be something that they're aware of or paying more attention to.
Yeah, that's a good point. And, you know, you want to protect the goalies, but we always talk, as long as it's consistent, I don't think anybody's got, look at Yager, he is really chirping at the ref there out at center ice. I mean, Yager was unhappy. He got held in the offensive zone. Gord Dwyer taking the wrath of the Yager comments there. But again, as long as it's consistent. You know, if you know if you're in the blue paint, they're not calling in the game, go to the blue paint. If they're going to call it, stay out.
You know, I think what's happening, Goldie, is there are more and more, you know, calls. And an interference call is one of those calls. It could be a major. And that's why whenever there's the possibility of an interference call, you have to think all four officials have a look at it. That's why I think they do that. And that's why you don't want officials to just turn their back on an obvious play.
Well, they've tightened it up here in the third. And, you know, letter of the law, the calls have been good calls. No doubt about that here in this third period, hopefully. Campbell with Desharnais. Desharnais works it free. Subban wheeling out in front of the net. Holding onto the puck. P.K. Subban. He set up the goal that gave Montreal the lead at 2-1. Stolen away, and Brandon Peary is out. Peary down the wing. Well, that's one. Try to let one go, but he fanned on the shot attempt. Boy, we're so used to him just teeing it up and blistering it. I jumped ahead of myself there.
That's kind of like swinging too hard on the first tee.
Here he is again. Yoking into the net. Peary blocked away, though.
And one more comment about the referees. Once they get to the Stanley Cup playoffs, the best referees, based on their season, they get judged every game, just like players. And they advance in the playoffs, the best referees advance, and then the best referees advance round by round by round until what they determine, the best referees make it to the Stanley Cup final. So there is some pressure on these referees to do the job and do it right. So there is accountability, whether you think there is or not.
Talking to the referees at times, I've always asked the same question. Of course, I only talk to them away from the rink. You're not supposed to be able to talk to them at the rink, maybe after the game. But their number one thing is to keep players safe. This is always the same answer. You could ask any one of the referees. That is their MO coming out of the dressing room. That's the first thing you want to be able to control on the ice. That's why the interference on goaltenders becomes an issue, because there's no play really where a guy is more in danger of getting hurt, because he's the last guy that expects to get hit.
And a lot of them are tough calls. I mean, you know, you go back last year in the Stanley Cup Finals, you know, and Lundqvist got knocked around a little bit on some plays. Loose in front here. McKenzie leaves it for Gudbranson, and the wrister is blocked. And some people still subscribe, hey, you know what, you're going for a Stanley Cup, let him play. But the rules are the rules, so, you know, the officials are very tough. And by the way, if you've never had the opportunity to sit close to the NHL game, the speed of the game is just remarkable. It is not an easy job, is what I'm trying to say, being down there and in that split second making those calls. Well, we chatted about the playoffs in the East. And here it is. Look at that scramble for those final two wildcard spots. And look over at Detroit in third place. They also have 95 points, and they're in Washington right now. Panthers would have loved to find another win or two somewhere along the way and be in that mix. Right now, they got 5:34 to go here in the third.
Well, we take a look at the game summary. How did we get here? Well, it was 1-0 for the Montreal Canadiens, a power play, and Ekblad fires at home. Everybody had a hand in that. The problem is it really wasn't very much time later that Gallagher gave his team a 2-1 lead, and that seemed to change the momentum. After that, P.A. Peranto skated about 180 feet. Nobody touched him, got his own rebound and scored. Little miscue in the defensive zone, and Devontae Smith-Pelly, who really wants to contribute offensively, got his chance, and he put it away.
Here's the chance, that shot goes high.
So you look for Coach Therrien, and he got a lot out of this game, there's no doubt about it. He got a power play goal. He's been wanting his team to continue getting better and better with a man advantage. He got guys like Parento, Smith-Pelly to contribute offensively. He was looking for more depth in scoring, and so he may have found something that is going to help the confidence of those players.
Yeah, you hope Max Pacioretty is okay. Boy, oh boy.
Yeah.
Hard to the boards early in the game. The 37-goal scorer for the Canadiens. What a great scorer and player he is. And you like to have that guy healthy for the playoffs. And Michel Therrien, the Canadiens, of course, great run last year, making it to the Eastern Conference Finals.
You know, you talk about creating momentum. I mean, these guys are locked into the playoffs. You know, might even be the, division champions. But there was no momentum, according to Michel Therrien. They were 1-2-3 in the last six games. No momentum, and that's what concerned him. That's why this is a big win for them, because they played well. They fixed any holes that the Florida Panthers might have created for them early in the game. They took responsibility. Coach has got to be happy with that.
Markov, Huberdeau, Jágr stay on here. Campbell back at his own end. Desharnais able to play it. Campbell now as Desharnais lost it, but Smith-Pelly with a steal.
Well, these guys are getting double shifted. Remember, these same guys were on the last power play.
Ekblad battling hard with Desharnais. Barkov takes the puck. Lead pass too far, though, for Campbell. Huberdeau, Willie Mitchell, and he'll flip it out to center. Camper hustling after with Tom Gilbert. Camper knocks it free. Trocheck there as well. Two aside battle deep in the Montreal zone. Peary now nearby. It's in there, the skates pinned to the boards. It's Camper with Gilbert, comes free, cross ice, Gudbranson. Up high for Willie Mitchell. The slap shot got through intentionally off the end boards. Trocheck backs it to the point. Gudbranson gives it back to Trocheck. The little foot pass didn't work, but then Trocheck able to give to Mitchell. Another shot. Oh, and hit the post. Peary shoots, saved by Price. Second post by a Panther defenseman. Remember when it was 1-1, Petrovic rang one off the iron that would have given Florida the lead. Montreal came right back and scored. Literally seconds later. And now we're going to get another penalty call here. Is this on that hit on Gudbranson? I think it is.
I find it very odd down there. Everybody's very mellow.
Well, I don't think Gudbranson really thought he got...
Montreal, 2 minutes, high staging.
Got hit that hard. Power play for the Panthers.
Well, his name is Beaulieu. And he... High sticking.
That's not
Beaulieu.
No, that's De La Rose on Gudbranson. So it was...
Maybe we missed it somewhere.
It had to be somewhere way in behind the play. Yeah, because Gudbranson never reacted. He didn't. I didn't think that play was a penalty, and it wasn't. So after Mitchell hit the post, Panthers get a power play here late in the game.
Well, if ifs were skiffs, we'd all be sailors.
Very prophetic. Jokinen try to break in cleanly, but it's an offside on the Panthers.
If we had hit the inside of the post. Jokinen, as we look at one of the veterans that has really come and brought some stability to this team, and obviously the learning process is one that you want to surround your young players with veterans. I mean, that was a role model by Bill Torrey back in the 70s when the fledgling Islanders became a dynasty. And Dale Talon has followed the same footsteps. You think of the players that were acquired in the offseason. Jokinen, obviously. Willie Mitchell, Thornton.
Campbell gives to Dave Bolin in the slot. Jokinen fires, save. Oh, and then the rebound just skipped over Brandon Peary's stick.
Why is it that Carey Price never looks nervous on any play? The smooth move from east to west, and the puck hit him right in the midsection.
He's the same way off the ice. He is just smooth. Here's a shot. Oh, getting a whistle here. And are they going to call a penalty, or do they think Price is...
I think they're going to try and talk everybody down. That was purely an accident. I think they caught skates. But you know what? I mean, you're the Montreal Canadiens. It's getting a little old here, wouldn't you think? Watch this now. Markov brings Jimmy Hayes into the goaltender, and I think they lock skates, and that's why Carey Price fell over.
So we just get a whistle.
Just get a whistle, a little talking to, and he's still talking. Carey, listen, you know, it wasn't really his fault, and, you know, maybe can you forgive him this time?
All right, the power play rolls on. Canadians, though, win the faceoff. Time winds down. This fifth and final meeting of the season. Every other one decided by a goal. Three went to overtime. Two of those to shootouts. But Montreal is going to win the season series from the Panthers.
Yep. Well, if you're looking at Montreal, they came into this game 3-0-1 against the Florida Panthers. The goalie always likes to look the other way, and it was actually 1-1-2.
Huberto for Barkov, chips in wide.
That's our point and theme of the game coming into this. The series against Montreal has been so close.
And it kind of epitomizes the Panther season, where you play well, and there are some games maybe you deserve two, or at least one more point that you just didn't quite get it at times.
You know what? One shot, one save could have made the difference in any one of those games. They went to the Montreal Canadiens. Not that they don't deserve it. I mean, they didn't get to 101 points just by, or 104 points, I should say, just by the series against the Florida Panthers. But it's certainly indicative of a team that plays 60 minutes, the Montreal Canadiens.
Carey Price has just had a phenomenal season. He continues it here tonight. Panthers had some real good opportunities, but Price turned them away. It's the 80th game of the year for Montreal, and they blew open what was a 1-1 game with three goals in the second period, and the Canadiens get the win here in South Florida, 4-1.
Well, for the Montreal Canadiens, it really has been a team effort. Carey Price has been outstanding. This was his first appearance in South Florida. But don't forget Tokarski, too. He was the other goaltender for the Montreal Canadiens, who actually played both games here in Florida and won them both.
So the Montreal Canadiens ending the season series in a dominant way, 4-0-1 against the Florida Panthers. And the Panthers will regroup, few days off, and Thursday night will come when the Boston Bruins come into town.
Montreal wins it. We go downstairs to Drew.
Goldie, thank you very much. Coming up on Panthers Live postgame, we're going to have all of the locker room reaction from the players as the Montreal Canadiens pick up the 4-1 win over the Florida Panthers. Of all the stats and analysis of this contest, and hear from head coach Gerard Gallant as well. Montreal pick up the victory in this one. The Panthers with two games left this season, both of them here at the BB&T Center. The Cats looking to close out their regular season strong on Thursday and on Saturday. But coming up after the break, we'll break down tonight's contest between Montreal and the Panthers as the Cats drop another one on today to Montreal. Panthers Live postgame is coming up right after this. Keep it right here.